I have my microphone on mute. Sorry about that. Welcome to Wesleyan United Methodist Church. It's a joy to be with you in the house of the Lord this day. Welcome to those of us who may be watching us on Facebook Live, and we are grateful that you are all here with us. Please remember to sign the hats that are along the center aisle of the pews and pass those down so that others may be seen. If you have not yet downloaded our smartphone app, we invite and encourage you to do so. The directions are found in the bulletin. And we do ask you to take your bulletin with you, the announcements, so that you can read what is in there and be up to date on the goings on in the life of the community. Next week, the first Sunday in June, we will have a big day. We will be recognizing our graduates, making our scholarship award decision or announcement. And we will also be celebrating all of our members who are 90 and older. And so I hope that you will be here to help us to celebrate all of that. Our summer hymn sing also begins next week. And we do that every summer between 9:30 and 9:45. If you would like to put in your favorite hymns, please do so using the insert found in your bulletin. Now is the time to fulfill those baptismal vows of helping to raise our children in the faith by volunteering to serve a Sunday or two for summer Sunday school. Joe Young is downstairs now with Allison Nijvig and will happily direct you to the sign-up if you go downstairs for coffee hour following worship. This evening at 11:15 third service relaunch meeting will be at 6:30 in the parlor. You are invited. Our next Vacation Bible School Work Day is this Wednesday, May 29th, from 5 to 7 in the Student Ministry Center. We would love for you to come and help us to get ready for Vacation Bible School. This Wednesday is also the night of one of our outdoor ministry events. So, Mike, would you raise your hands? Mike Petit-Dimanche, if you are planning to join this hike, it's a meetup at Wesleyan Church and Go to McClemens Woods. It's a light hike on a gentle terrain, 1 mile loop. Meet here at the church at 6 o'clock. Let Mike know if you're planning to go so that the carpooling runs smoothly. We do not presently have anyone in the hospital that I know of. We do need to continue to pray for Vivian Clow, Tom's mother, who has been being ill, her prognosis is that she's not going to really get better. So we're trying to figure out next steps of care. So please keep Tom and Vivian in your prayers. Yes, sir. Yes. Oh, David is in the hospital. Oh,
yes, it's very sick.
I did not know that. Thank you. All right, so we will pray for David Snell. Debbie and Jim's dad, who has really had a rough couple of months, and we will hold him in prayer if he is in the congenital life zone, right? Okay, so we will hold him in prayer. Thank you. Yes, do we have the red microphone around? If we could have the usher bring it forward. Yes, Carolyn, I will repeat what you said. She went for what on Friday? Back surgery. Okay. We will pray for your sister-in-law, Sandy Rhodes, who had back surgery on Friday. Okay, and I see Alex has his hand raised. Thank you, Amy. I didn't see the microphone in your hand. I thought you were offering to repeat it.
I have a praise to bring to you this morning. A dear friend of mine, Dr. Arthur Gilbert, has been released from the hospital. Dr. Gilbert teaches at Wellington University. I think mixed up. They both start with a W. Anyway, Dr. Gilbert is also a Rotarian and introduced Nancy to myself. So that was a good thing. He has been released from the hospital that he was admitted on the 14th after having difficulties from a pacemaker that he's inserted. And he's back home and on the mend. And I'm so glad to be able to report that he's doing well.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. All right. See, no other hand. Oh, see? taking one more hand. Yes, Don. Larry. I was about to be shocked.
No, yeah. I tried. This is just a follow-up to the 40 acts of generosity that we all, that many of us participated in Lent, and we just had a few more turned in that we got a hold of them, and we'd like to announce that to Pat Liske, Janet Flowers, Katherine Mahoney, and Dorothy Harrison all participated, and we thank you very much for that.
Praise God. Thank you.
And also on the proof, I'm going to mention about next Sunday being Pentecost and wearing red.
Oh, yeah, that was on here. I skipped over it somehow. Thank you. So a couple of things about upcoming. Two Sundays from now is Pentecost Sunday, so that's June 9th. And that is the story of the birthday of the church when the flames of the Spirit rest upon the believers. And so in the spirit of flames, we ask you to wear red. We're going to try and take a fun picture of everybody in our red flames. My family and I will be taking a big trip this summer. So there's 5 Sundays in June. Those last 3 Sundays we will be away. The first Sunday is the 3rd Sunday of June, which is Father's Day, and so Tom Welch is going to be reading a message that day. The following Sunday, on the 23rd, Tom's back there acting like that's news to him. the following Sunday, Reverend Jack Chitama from Cometh will be our preacher, and the final Sunday in June, this Sunday in June, Reverend Lester Justice, who is on staff at the conference office, Director of Strengthening the Black Church, will be our preacher, and I think it's going to be a fun time to get to have some guest preachers, so I leave you in good hands. We will be traveling together in Europe, so this is Shannon's summer between junior and senior year. We're taking the big trip, so we're excited about that. All right, any other announcements? Okay, let us now enter into our time of silence and centering as we prepare for worship. And then we will stand together and sing number 428 on this Memorial Day Sunday.
pray. Loving God, we confess that we are anxious people who deny your blessings and fail to keep your word. Forgive us, we pray, for these and all our sins, that we might live in peace and reflect your love in the world. Through Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Let your hearts be still, for God loves you and forgives you all your wrongdoing. Beloved, receive the peace of Christ. Amen.
Thank you. Let us pray. Living God, you sent your apostle to preach the gospel to women gathered by the river in a secluded place of prayer. There's a businesswoman named Lydia, was led by the Spirit to hear your word is true. You opened her heart in love, and she opened her home for the spreading of the gospel. By the power of your Holy Spirit, fling wide the doors of our hearts this day as we hear your word wide, that we too may open our lives to serve your world in love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you to honor Christ and stand in body and spirit or spirit with the gospel reading. The gospel lesson this morning is John 14, verses 23 through 29, and may be found in your pew Bible on page 103. Jesus answered him, "Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but is from the Father who sent me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all the things that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I'm going away, and I'm coming to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you this before it occurs, so that when it does occur, you may believe." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My name is Lydia, and I will always remember the day that Paul and his companions arrived by the riverbank in Philippi. It's amazing that Paul arrived at all. First, he was given a vision in which he saw a man pleading with Paul to come to Macedonia. And then when Paul set out to follow that vision, he had to be prompted by the Spirit twice not to go in a different direction, in the wrong direction. And of course, before all of that, there were controversies about whether or not we Gentiles were even allowed to be full members of the community without following the practices of the Jews. Clearly, the Spirit was at work, because all of this happened to get Paul and I to that riverbank on that day. Looking back, I can only say that our steps were guided and our hearts were opened by the power of the Holy Spirit. I had been a God-fearer for a long time. A God-fearer is a person, usually one of us Gentiles, who gathers with the Jewish community for worship, but hasn't made that final commitment to become a member of the community. And I was drawn to this Jewish community by the power of their relationships with one another, the depth of their integrity and character, and the devotion that I saw in their lives for God. I had also heard about this Jesus who hadn't. I mean, word had traveled far and wide that he might be the Messiah, and that he did amazing things like healing tax collectors and sinners, that he included women in the circle of his leadership and treated them with the same respect as men. I had even heard that it was the women who followed Jesus who had stayed with him to the end, that they were the ones who first reported these amazing stories of his rising again to life. And as a trader in purple cloth who runs my own household, I was eager to hear more about this man who had such deep respect for women, for this man who welcomed sinners and ate with them. When I heard Paul preaching about Jesus, that night when he found that there wasn't a man in our household, he was just grateful to see the Holy Spirit at work. It felt like my life's pain was finally easing, and that I was being filled with fresh peace and hope. I was overjoyed when Paul accepted my invitation for he and his traveling companions to come and stay in our household. God opened my heart, and I immediately felt led to open my home. It allowed me to become a part of sharing this good news with other people in Philippi. And as a successful trader, we have room to spare. I was honored to be chosen to serve. And now I know that God is directing me to use the wealth that God has given me to support missionaries near and far. And I seek to remain open to all that the Holy Spirit has for me. Thanks be. Some of you will hear me comment some weeks that I feel like God, for whatever reason, does this to me and doesn't give me the last little piece of my sermon until either Saturday night or Sunday morning when I wake up. Usually in the shower or when I'm just falling asleep or just waking up, you know, when I'm still not quite 100% aware and God is able to, like, get to me a little better, I think. And this morning, as I was in the shower, this is what occurred to me. For a woman like Lydia to be the head of her own household and to be a successful businesswoman in her own rights, in a day and time where that was extremely rare, means that somehow her path must have traveled through what I'm betting was significant pain. Either she had lost a beloved husband and was left to figure out how to navigate the world without him in her life, in which circumstances many women became impoverished, but not Lydia. Or she came out of difficult circumstances like buying her way out of slavery, or enduring some sort of abusive relationship that had ended, or possibly being divorced. None of the paths that lead her to being the head of her own household and a trader were likely through ease. Somehow, she must have walked through a difficult path in order to get to the riverbank that day. And so she had likely been at the riverbank many weeks before. It was a custom in various places around the ancient Near East that if there wasn't a synagogue constructed in town, that they would gather at a designated spot, the Jewish people and the God-fearing Gentiles, and they would gather at this designated spot for worship. So all through the book of Acts and Paul's letters, you see references to Paul going to these communities and preaching to them about the way of following Jesus Christ. And so we have this woman, Lydia, who is now hearing a fresh word from the Apostle Paul and his traveling companions about, as we hear from the Gospel of John, this peace that we are promised. And I can imagine that hearing that word of promised peace must have been a blessing to Lydia and to all of those who gathered at the riverbank that day. It's the farewell discourse that we hear in the Gospel of John. It's the part of the story where Jesus is preparing his followers for what comes next. And it is in this farewell discourse that Jesus says, "I am going away, and I am coming to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." What must it have been like to be with Jesus in those final days and hours? To hear him talking about his own impending death, after following him for 3 years and thinking that he was going to change everything, only to learn that instead he was going to die. How terrifying must that have been? If for no other reason, even if some of them had believed Jesus' predictions of his own death, this was going to be a huge change And, you know, raise your hand if you love huge changes, right? And so Jesus is saying to his disciples, I'm going away. And when I go away, the Holy Spirit, the Advocate, whom the Father will send in my name, will come and teach you everything. And this promise of God's presence is one that we revel in and rejoice in even today. It is the way that we understand that God is present, that God's peace is available to us when we open ourselves to the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit. Many people yearn for peace on the world's terms, cessation of conflict or war, perhaps cessation of tension or psychological suffering, a sense of calm or serenity of spirit. The peace that Jesus promises as he prepares to take leave may include such things, but the peace that Jesus gives is nothing less than the consequence of being in the presence of God. And that's part of what it means to follow Jesus, is to learn to pay attention to the truth that God is present to us every moment of every day. That is assured. The question is whether we practice paying attention. Whether we, as Paul says in another one of his letters, we learn to pray without ceasing, to pay attention to that presence of the Spirit that promises us the peace that comes when we do. That's one of the reasons that I love yoga so much. It is a prayer practice that is dedicated to paying attention to the present moment where God is, to paying attention to the presence of the Holy Spirit that is always as near as our breath. And the question for us as followers of the way is, will we, like Lydia, cultivate that awareness of God always being as close as our breath? Because when we are able to recognize that God is indeed present, peace is made manifest. Communities that include the sign of peace during worship, as we do near the end of our service, are enacting the truth that we know that our sin is forgiven, and that this community of peace is part of the new reality of what God is doing. The gift of peace is bound up with all that makes for righteousness and right relationship, love, forgiveness, reconciliation, and thanksgiving. Freedom from anxiety is directly related to our putting our whole trust in God's grace and love, which becomes possible as we remember that in love, God created us for love. Some of you have heard me talk about family systems theory, which is something that was written about by actually a Jewish rabbi at first, Ed Friedman, who talks about the ways that we become a non-anxious presence by knowing who we are, I would say, in Christ. And as we become clear about who we are and where we stand in life, we are better able to stay non-anxious, to be peaceful in all kinds of situations. How many of us know what it is like to be at a family gathering wondering whether Aunt so-and-so will have too much to drink or Uncle Who's-It will have one of his spells? In the same way, most families know how everyone calms down when father gets home or when mother steps in and takes charge. The capacity of that peaceful presence, that non-anxious presence, calms everyone down. It is the presence of the Spirit. This is similar to what happens in the presence of God at a time of peace that is not as the world gives. Consider that occasion after the resurrection when the disciples were afraid and gathered behind locked doors. I mean, I probably would have been gathered behind locked doors, afraid too, our leader having just been crucified, right? And then on that third day, Jesus coming and standing among them, and he says in John 20:19, peace be with you. And immediately they felt at peace. was, and is that non-anxious presence of God. Jesus' own capacity for setting aside anxiety, for putting his full trust in God's love and grace, is shown in John 20, verse 30, when he refers to the ruler of this world. Jesus' conflict with the religious authorities of his day was introduced near the beginning of the Gospel of John, in the second chapter, in that story of Jesus cleansing the temple. And anyone who followed the story thus far must expect that there will be some sorts of unhappy ending. Even Jesus is aware that he is going to his own death. The Gospel of John doesn't show us the agony in the Garden of Gethsemane like Matthew and Mark and Luke. Instead, we see Jesus, who is confident that he is with God and that the ruler of the world will not be able to exert power over him. When Jesus says in 20:31, "Rise, let us be on our way," Jesus is speaking of the way that will lead to his death, the way of the cross. And he is confident that death is not the worst fate in life. The worst fate would be to act without faith and integrity, breaking faith with the source of his life. So how do we stay in touch with the Holy Spirit that promises us peace? How do we practice being that kind of non-anxious presence among our families and friends and community? Part of it has to do with learning to tune in moment by moment to the presence of the Holy Spirit. And some people might call it following your gut. I would call it following the promptings of the Holy Spirit. And as I was thinking about an example of this, I thought of kind of a silly one, but it's still an example. A couple of Fridays ago, I was driving home from visiting somewhere, and it was almost the end of the day, and I felt like, oh, I mean to go to those two stores that I'm driving by right now. Now's the time, you know, about a couple extra minutes. So I go into store number one, find what I need, and as I'm about to walk next door to store number two, I get this nudge, like, not supposed to go to store number two. So I turned around, got in the car, went home. Now, I could have very easily thought, oh, that's silly, I'm just going to go get what I need, right? But trying to practice paying attention to those little tiny nudges and trust that God is with me even as I'm deciding whether or not to walk into that store and to pay attention. Those are the ways that we begin and practice cultivating the awareness of God's presence all around us. It is in this way that we come to rely on God's peace and presence guiding us, and to discern where it is that we have decisions we can make, and where it is that we don't have control. I was listening this week to an interview with a mom who was talking about her 9-year-old and 13-year-old daughters, who are just far enough apart to always argue and know how to push each other's buttons. And she was, you know, she says, I must say this every day. You can't control your sister. The only thing that you can control is your reaction to your sister. Don't let her push your buttons, right? And of course, the mom's the only one who's going to discipline the sister. And she said, I think the message might be finally getting through because the other day I heard the 9-year-old say my words to the 13-year-old. This week, I was reading in my devotional an excerpt from the book Taking Flight by Anthony DeMello, and these words really struck me. They are, nothing surpasses the holiness of those who have learned perfect acceptance of everything that is. In the game of cards called life, one plays the hand one is dealt to the best of one's ability. Those insist on playing not the hand they were given, but the one they insist they should have been dealt, these are life's failures. We are not asked if we will play. That is not an option. Play we must. The option is how. How will we live this life according to the presence of the Holy Spirit? How will we embrace that presence that is with us every moment, every breath, every day? How will we walk in ways that lead to life, trusting that God will guide and direct us, just as God opened the way for Lydia to receive that word that she needed to hear that day through visions and promptings and guiding her to be there at that moment to hear those words, we too can pay attention to the presence of the Spirit in our lives and thus live day by day in a growing experience of God's peaceful presence with us always. This is the promise that Jesus gives to his disciples leading up to his crucifixion. And this is the promise that we have throughout our days. Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you now to join with me in an attitude of prayer on this Memorial Day Sunday. I will be using the Memorial Day prayer from the Book of Worship. And I want to say a special word of acknowledgement. One of our lay leaders, Larry Josephowski, had republished on his Facebook page a column that he had written for Dover Post for Memorial Day in 2005. And I had read it before, and I read it again, and it brought tears again. It was a beautiful tribute to one of the soldiers with whom he served, who lost his life in, I can't remember if it's Iraq or Afghanistan, thank you. Let us pray. Almighty God, before whom stand the living and the dead, we, your children, whose mortal life is but a hand's breadth, give thanks to you. For all those whom you have blessed our pilgrimage, whose lives have empowered us, whose influence is a healing grace, we lift up thankful hearts. For the dear friends and family members whose faces we see no more, but whose love is with us forever, the teachers and companions of our childhood and youth, and for the members of our household of faith who worship you now in heaven, we lift up thankful hearts. For those who sacrifice themselves, our brothers and sisters who have given their lives for the sake of others, we lift up thankful hearts. That we may hold them all in continual remembrance and ever think of them as with you in that city whose gates are not shut by day, where there is no night, we lift up thankful hearts. That we may now be dedicated to working for a world where labor is rewarded, fear dispelled, and the nations made one. O Lord, save your people and bless your heritage. Day by day we magnify you and worship your name forever and ever. Amen. And now, in the name of the one who taught us to pray, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please rise in body or in spirit as we sing together number 663, Savior Again to Thy Dear Name.
Thank you.
would share this offering that others too may be blessed. For the sake of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
remain standing for these words of benediction, and then join us downstairs for coffee and fellowship, and continue to share signs of Christ's peace with one another. Go forth in peace, and remember that we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who make the journey with us, and so be swift to love. Make haste to be kind. May the grace of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us this day and always. And all of God's people say,
Amen.
Amen. Let us sing.
Thank you.
Thanks for next week.
I forgot to put that thing down.
You want it all the way down?
No, I try to remember to put it down like that after the... These people here say they can't see the number.
Yeah. Dave's crab tie.
help you.
All right, I got it all. Don't have that much. This last Sunday? This was the last Sunday?
Yeah, so the back room will be
empty, huh?
How's it going, Joshua?
It's going.
Where's Michael? Where's Mike? My surfer.
What's going on?
What? What's going on?
So what do you have? Just you and Amy? Is that why she rushed back?
And technology.
How about the drum? So what do you want me to do? What can I do? I got 1 week of work till Thursday left. I wear a sweater and a jacket all the time. Turn the heat on it. Up on the chair. Way, way up.
I can't send the boys to the community.
Yes.
Oh, well.
ask you.